Yeah, you're gonna have to
because that's what I thought would be interesting this weekend, is to ask a question I rarely see people ask. How come I want to sleep? Because I've sort of noticed that you folks don't like saying you want to do a thing that you're doing. Isn't that about right? A voice comes into your head and says, when I don't want to sleep, I want to be awake. And so you say, I want to be awake. And then you sleep. You're okay with that contradiction, aren't you? The voice is right, not what you do. Am I correct? Hello.
Morning.
That is about the way it goes, isn't it? I hear people tell me that all the time. I want to do such and such. Well, are you doing such and such? No. Well, it sounds to me like you don't want to do such and such. No, I want to. That doesn't make a lot of sense to me. When I want to do a thing, I just sort of do it. Can you imagine if people said that about going to the grocery store? I want to go to the grocery store. Well, okay. What's stopping you? Nothing. Oh, okay. So when are you going to do it? Oh, I don't know. I want to. Usually when I want to go to the grocery store, I just go grab the keys and drive off, don't you? So, could you entertain the thought that if you're saying you want to do a thing and you're not doing it, that maybe it's because you actually don't want to? And understand that part of having a personality is that it says all sorts of things that are not true. And just because you have a thought doesn't mean a thing. It doesn't mean anything, does it? It's just a passing thought. I want to do this. But there doesn't seem to be any actual desire behind that thought, does there? Or you'd probably be doing it. So I'd like to start out with, oh, I can't write. I'd like to start out with that question. If I want to be awake, then what's going on that I'm not just working at being awake? Maybe it's because I actually don't want to much of the time. It is possible to want something now, and then not want it in 2 seconds, isn't it? I often say to people, yeah, I suppose you do want it, but apparently you want something else more, because that's the way it works. Do you understand that? You will only do whatever is of first value to you now, the thing that is the most valuable. And everybody always has a list of values that are ranked by which one is more valuable, okay? I always have a list of what we call a relative value. And at any given time, something moves on that list, doesn't it? So you can look at the list and say, I want to do this, but if it always stays at the bottom, it never gets done. You understand that? There are always things more valuable, higher than that, and that's what I do. I do the one that is most valuable to me right this moment. So perhaps you are putting value on being awake, but how often does that get to be first value, so it's what you do? You understand? So you can have this weird thing where you go around telling people, I want to do something, but I don't do it. Because you always want something else more. Now, if you understand that, if you actually looked into that idea that I have a whole ranking of, hello, a whole ranking of value, this situation would make sense, wouldn't it? Yeah, I do want to be awake, but I don't want it very often as first value. So, So what's your experience with doing this, huh? How often does being aware, waking up out of this weird dream that you live in, how often does that become first value? A lot?
Not as often as I like to think.
So you lie about how often it happens. Okay. Well, that's useful. Maybe if I lie enough and say I have $1 million in the bank, I can go buy a Rolls Royce. You think that'll work?
No, I don't
think so. Oh, damn. I thought maybe if it worked for you, it'd work for me. Did you bring pens?
Yes.
Oh, good. I feel naked without a pen. This is like one of those bad dreams. Wake up and you're standing in front of a whole group of people naked. Because I didn't have a pen, so naked. So if we look at it from that point of view, all right, our value system always has something that is most valuable and goes down to things that are not valuable, and things are constantly moving on that. At any given time, I have a whole bunch of things that I value that are on a scale, and something is always at the top. When it's the most valuable thing, I do something about it. I take an action of some kind that normally takes it off, doesn't it? And it disappears for a while. And then it shows up down here again. Isn't that right? And then it slowly works its way back up to most valuable, and then I act on it, because I'm only acting on the thing that has most value to me. Do you see that? That's going on all the time. That's the way that you live. Constant value system. And the things, the events that are going on, move on it continuously, isn't that right? So my favorite example is hunger. Because sensations make this really clear, don't they? All of a sudden the sensation of hunger starts happening. And it's way down here. I care about being hungry, don't you? I want to eat, just not now. And that sensation slowly gets more and more insistent and demands more and more of the attention, doesn't it? And it works its way up until finally it becomes the most valuable thing there is to get food, and I go eat. And then it just vanishes. I don't value eating at all anymore. Isn't that right? I don't even think about eating for a few hours. And then conditions change, and I start feeling it again. It worms its way back to the top. Now that's the way it works, isn't it? With everything. And whatever happens to be of first value, the most valuable thing, that's what I'm doing. Because I can only do so much at one time. Isn't that about right? It's very difficult for we humans to do more than one thing at a time, isn't it? And I do the thing that's at the top. So I've often recommended to people that they actually keep track of how much time they spend doing the work, and that tells you very clearly how often being aware gets to be of first value. You don't have to make up these stories anymore. You can just see how often it is to be of first value. I've noticed for most of the folks sitting in this room, that isn't real often. Do you agree with that or not?
Yeah.
So you want it, but there's a whole bunch of other stuff that manages to beat it from being at the top of the list, huh? And the interesting thing is about being aware is it's one of the few things that I can do while I'm doing everything else. Isn't that right? There's actually absolutely no reason for it never to be at the top, is it? Because whatever else I'm doing, I could do it with awareness, couldn't I? Is there anything that you can't do with awareness? Can you not cook dinner with awareness? Is that impossible? It's just absolutely impossible to cook dinner and be aware of cooking dinner. See, this is one thing that you can't actually combine with everything else. So a rather famous man said a very, very long time ago, he said, seek ye first. Isn't that right? He apparently understood this idea of valuing the kingdom of heaven. You've heard that before? That sounds like a good recipe to me. Keep that at the top all the time. Because you can do it with everything else, can't you? There's no obstruction to being in a wonderful inner environment, no matter what else is going on, is there? I can be aware. I can be in a wonderful inner place no matter what is going on. Period. First time they put me in jail, I discovered that was true. I can even do it in jail. As far as I was concerned, that was the least likely place to try and be in a good mood. It was in jail, okay? But suddenly I found myself in jail, and I said, well, this is intolerable. So I think I'm going to have to learn really fast how to be in the kingdom of heaven, even in this little bitty box. Or I'm going to go nuts. And I found out I could even do it there. So I'd have the sneaky suspicion that I can do this. When I'm broke, helpless, I know I can do it toothless. Without means sustenance under any conditions. You understand? I can be broke and helpless and wondering where my next meal is coming from and what I'm going to eat it with anyway, and still be aware. I can do that under any conditions. So there really is no particular reason for it not to be of first value at all times, is there? Can you name me a reason? Am I missing something that you know about? Because I figure you must know more on this subject than I do. I'm obviously not an expert at this one, so you tell me, is there some reason why being aware cannot be of first value all the time that you know of?
Well, there must be some reason.
Yeah, but I did add to the end. I finished my sentence, didn't I? Yeah. I finished the sentence. I said, that you know of. Yes, you're right, there must be some reason. You know what it is. That's what I asked. See, I sort of suspected you didn't. That's why I came here this weekend. Was to tell you. I figured if you knew, you'd probably change it, you know? Apparently you don't know, but that's my whole point. Obviously, you do think there is a damn good reason for not making it a first value all the time, don't you? Because it doesn't show up there a whole lot, does it? But I could leave being aware, doing the work, whatever words you want to use for that. The work is a technical term, by the way, around here. It means only a particular activity. I could leave that at the top for the rest of this life if I chose to, and still do everything else. So that's the end of this sentence, if you aren't aware of this sentence very well. It says, seek first the kingdom of heaven and all things else will be given to you. So it doesn't say that this becomes mutually exclusive, which you'd like to believe, huh? I know a lot of people who say, well, I can't do this until. Well, you're wrong. You can do this now. And do that other thing that you are putting it off for. I can't do this until I don't have money worries anymore. Right? You can't ask me to be aware when I'm worried about money. Why? Why can't you do it when you're worried about money? Sort of looks to me like something I can be aware of being worried about money. I've done it many times. In fact, one of the reasons for doing it, as far as I was concerned, was so I'd stop worrying about money. I was sick and tired of it. So now when I'm broke, I don't worry about money, because I finally understood worrying about money, and I saw how ridiculous it was that that did not help one iota. I did not get rich by worrying about money. Anybody here ever get rich that way? You sat down and you just worried up a storm. And you went and looked at your bank account and had more money in it. That ever worked for anybody? That ever worked for me? It sort of seemed to me that worrying about money was a good way to get poorer, because then I wasn't doing anything to make money. So I did pay a lot of attention to that at one point in life. And I discovered the most remarkable thing. Every time I needed money, it just appeared. It was just about as goofy as going and checking somebody come give it to me. Never failed. And I suspect it's never failed for you either, or you would be dead. Isn't that about right? You would have gotten into one of those circumstances where you really needed money, and it didn't show up, and you dropped dead because you needed it or to live. So apparently it works that way for everybody. They just don't pay enough attention to realize it, so they gotta play the worry game, because they don't know. It always comes somehow. I understand. To me, that's a good reason for keeping this up here. I started to understand a lot of the screwball things I did in sleep that I didn't really want to do. I did not want to worry about money. It wasn't any fun. And it didn't help anything. It sure didn't help me make money. Does that make sense? So I wanted to be aware of it and see if someday I could see the illusion in it and not have to do it anymore. Now, how are you going to notice that funny little fact if you're not paying attention? Every time I worry about money, just before I actually run out and die, it shows up. Sometimes from the weirdest places, from totally unexpected places. And sometimes from where I expected it to come. But it always shows up. And you notice that half a dozen times, and you say, okay, I'm not going to worry about it anymore. The seventh time, I'll just sit and wonder where it's coming from instead of worrying. And that's what I do. When I run out of money and I got to have some, I sit and think about, gee, I wonder where it's going to come from. I bet it's going to be a really surprising source, because I can't even imagine this time where it's going to come from. And I just sit and wait to see what bizarre source it's going to come from this time. It's actually kind of fun. Now, this one's going to be pretty surprising, I bet you. And that's actually kind of fun, instead of being all worrisome. Do you understand? You could be doing work all the time. You could be aware all the time. There's really no impediment to that that I can see, no obstruction to it. Except maybe something going on inside here, okay? But I don't see any real reason why I can't be aware all the time. You can be aware when you're in a coma if you want to. You can be aware when your body goes to sleep if you want to. It's kind of weird, but you can do it. You can do it anytime you want. But we don't. So can we take a look at this thing that says I want to do it, but I'm not, and maybe see that there is a good reason for that. It's because I always want something else more, and stop playing this game of getting upset with someone. When you say, I want to do such and such, and they say, well, apparently you don't want it very much because you're not doing it. And maybe see, that's the truth. Yeah, I guess I don't. But I can do something about that. Once I admit the truth of the matter and say, yeah, I guess that's true, I really don't want it as much as I'm saying I do, then I can change my mind, can't I? But how am I going to change my mind when I won't even admit what's true? No, no, you don't understand. I want it. I want it more than life itself. That's never going to be true then if you lie about it, is it? So, can we look into this idea? This is the way it really works in the life, okay? I always have a scale of values. Many, many values. I don't just have one, do I? At any time, I have quite a number of values going on, things that I care about, that I'm interested in, that I want to do, that value system. Only one of them is at the top, and that's what I'm doing. And it'll stay to the top until I stop doing it. That means it went somewhere else. It moved down, it went off the list. One of the ideas of any spiritual teaching that I've ever looked at is that you make sure that whatever spiritual thing you're doing, so-called, is always at the top, because you can keep it at the top while you do everything else. We had an amusing to this one conversation earlier in the day. Somebody said, do you know about silver mind control, which I have not heard of in probably 30 years. And I said, oh yeah, I know about silver mind control. And they have this thing where you're supposed to meditate, right? Like a lot of other people, and they teach you how. So many, many years ago, when I was a very young man, somebody who taught silver mind control decided that he liked me, and so he taught me without paying him all those hundreds of dollars. See? That's how you learn things. If you don't have any money, befriend people. How much did you pay to learn that stuff?
I don't remember.
It was a lot of money, though, wasn't it?
It wasn't cheap.
That's right. I got it for free, and I didn't even want it. So anyway, he taught me how to sit there and go into the theta state. That's what they call meditation, okay? Going into the theta state. So I tried it. And we sat there for, you know, 20, 30 minutes in the theta state. And then we stopped. And a little while later, a few days later, let's do it again. It's like, okay. So I sit there for 20, 30 minutes in the theta state. And we did that several times. And after we did it, about the third or fourth time, I sort of said, so what's the point? Why are we doing this? And he looked at me and he said, you know, I bet you walk around in the theta state and you're not noticing a damn thing. Well, yeah, isn't that the point? What is the point of sitting and meditating for 20 or 30 minutes a day? Why don't you live in that state? You could. The only point I can see for it is that you don't live in that state, and so I guess you want to experience it for a half hour, and that seems valuable to me. I can't argue with that. But were it me, I would make the aim to just live there. Why would you want to be anywhere else? People tell me that the effect for them is that they get calm, and they get peaceful, and they get at one with things, and they stop thinking all those horrible, conflicting thoughts. Would you explain to me why you don't want to just live there? You prefer to spend most of your time in those horrible conflicting thoughts, not at peace, overwhelmed by worry and thinking, and then occasionally visit the theta state in meditation. This is your preferred method of living? Now, the answer is yes, isn't it? It sounds funny as hell when somebody puts it that way, but the actual answer is yes, that's the way I prefer to live, obviously, because that's the way I live, isn't it? So I got a real, real kick recently. A friend said that they bought a tape that had been made of the fellow who taught me about all this stuff at a workshop in California. I don't know why I missed this one. I was not there. I would have loved to have seen this. And in that workshop, he apparently said to everybody there, "I need your help. There's something that I just cannot understand, so you're going to have to explain it to me. I need you to help me out with this one. You've all experienced altered states, and you don't want to live there. I don't get it." Now, I've been putzing with trying to figure that out for years now. And now I find out nobody knows why you do this. Apparently you don't, because you can't explain it. I sure don't. The man who taught me couldn't figure it out. So nobody knows why you do this. So, but it is the truth, isn't it? Yes, my preferred method of living is to be in this horrible, weird, jumbled up mess of a mind most of the time and occasionally take a trip to a nice, pleasant place. For a vacation, I guess. Yeah, that's the way I prefer. So that's what I would like to do this weekend, to see if we can answer the question, why? Why do I want to do that? That's kind of strange, isn't it? Or do you disagree with me? Do you think that's like a good idea? Yes. I would prefer to live in this low, ridiculous, jumbled mess most of the time, and on occasion visit a nice place just to remind myself that there are nice places in the world. And then I'll go home to my slum. Because that's what I decided a long time ago. Everyone has an inner and an outer world, isn't that about right? You don't live in one world, you live in two at the same time. You have an inner world, which is the world of feelings and perceptions and thoughts and all that stuff. That's all the inner world, isn't it? And then you have an outer world out here, the world of sensation, isn't that correct? You live in them both at the same time. That's why we can be aware and do other things, because since we live in two worlds, life had to give us a way to pay attention to both at the same time. So we all have that ability, otherwise we couldn't exist. You're not aware of having that ability, you can only go between the two, can't you? You're either absorbed in your inner world and you forget the outer one exists, or you're absorbed in the outer one and you forget the inner one exists. Isn't that about right? But you do actually have the ability to pay attention to both at the same time. So if we accept that idea that I actually live in two worlds at the same time, an inner world and an outer world, and I decided a long time ago that most people live in the slums of the inner world. That sound about right? You live in this place where there's garbage all over the streets, and it stinks, and everybody's miserable. Isn't that about right most of the time? And you visit nice places. So in California, I guess, you know, you'd be living in Venice, but you'd occasionally visit Beverly Hills, so you could be jealous of people who don't live in the slums. I don't know if you know about Venice, but it's a very amusing amusing place many years ago when Mr. Reagan was the governor of California. He came up with the bright notion of saving money, which California was having trouble with at the time, by closing all the mental institutions, because that would save the taxpayers a lot of money if they didn't have to pay for those incredibly expensive places where they put people who have mental problems, right? And I've always assumed that he felt that was perfectly justifiable because there was Venice. They could all go there, which we did. I lived there for a while. It was a very bizarre place. I don't know what that would be like in Houston. I'm sure you know where the slums are, okay? That's kind of where you live in the inner world, and then you visit the nice parts of Houston, isn't that about right? On occasion. Strange, isn't it? Why would anyone want to do that? I've noticed most people's answer to that question is, I have to. So apparently there is someone in the inner world, a very powerful figure with a whip in hand, who every time you approach the nice places starts cracking it and drives you back. Isn't that right? That's why you have to. I have noticed that's the answer you get from people a lot of the time. I have to. I can't do anything else. So why would I want to do this? Why? Anybody disagree with my description of things? Why would I want to do this? You think the description is just ridiculous? Okay. Why would a person want to do that? Why would they want to put first value on worries, fears, anxieties, hatreds, revenges? Why would they want to put first value on these things when they've experienced something else?
Guilt, programming, you punish yourself. Possibly.
I said, why would you want to? You want to do that? You want to punish yourself?
That's what I'm saying. Maybe you feel guilty and you feel like you...
Maybe I don't.
Yeah, Phil, I think that I do have what looks like a benefit to me for doing that. It motivates me to do
something. Good. What is that motivation? Because that's what I think.
And I don't know. And it doesn't make any sense, really. But I kind of being in a place...
Well, apparently it does.
I'm sorry?
Apparently it does make sense. And that's what I'd like to answer this weekend. Yes, it's very true. You do have a reason for doing it, quite obviously. You're absolutely correct. So is he. What is it? I accept that without any qualifications at all. Yeah, you do think you have a good reason for doing it. I can't believe that you'll do anything so bizarre without what seems to you like a very good reason. So what is it?
I think for me, it motivates me to do things. Like, for instance, fear. I'll subject myself to, like, this long list of horrible things that are going to happen if I don't take this action. That I can't find any other way to make myself do it, maybe, just right off the top of my head.
That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. You have other motivations, don't you, that you're aware of? Is that why you go to a bar at night? Because you have to work yourself up to be afraid not to? On the nights that you go to a bar somewhere? You don't do that from fear, do you? You do that for a much more reasonable reason. You hope that something neat is going to happen. Isn't that about right? No? Yeah. So don't you think that's a lot better motivation to do something because you kind of hope that something neat is going to happen than for fear of some monstrous, horrible event? If you're going to work yourself up for the purpose of motivating, wouldn't it make more sense to focus on the neat things that would happen if I did it instead of that horrible fear? So I don't think that's really true. I don't think you're doing it to motivate yourself. You know better ways to motivate yourself, don't you? You could lie to yourself about wonderful things that are going to happen instead of lying to yourself about horrible things that are going to happen. Isn't that right? It'd be a lot more fun. Might be a little more disappointing. But it'd be a lot more fun getting to the disappointment, wouldn't it? So if that's the real reason, is doing it to motivate yourself, there's something behind that too, isn't there? Can you see what that is? You don't think you can do it any other way. You wouldn't use that method unless you thought it was your only possible method, would you? You wouldn't do it by choice. If you could choose between saying, I'm gonna motivate self by building up a dream of a wonderful thing that's going to happen, and on the other hand, I could motivate me by dreaming of this terrible, monstrous catastrophe, would you actually pick that one? Pick the worry and the fear if you had the choice? I don't think so either. So that in order to pick that one, you've got to say, I don't think I can do it any other way. Isn't that about right? Why do you think that? So in order to answer the question, now we've got to answer this other question. Why the hell do you think that that's the only way you can be motivated? By fear. So we still haven't answered the question yet. That may be absolutely true.
Maybe at some point it worked for you. At some point, so it's going to work again.
As opposed to the motivation of, gee, this would be wonderful and I'd really enjoy it. That never worked for you.
Yeah, that's worked.
I see. So I don't think you answered the question. That is my proposition here. If you have a choice between doing it a really neat, pleasant way and a choice of doing it a really unpleasant way, then your natural inclination, of course, is to pick the most horrible one, isn't it? Not. So you're lying. You just said the same thing he did, which I went on this long discussion about, to say, I don't buy it. And maybe you do believe that. I don't know. But it doesn't make any sense to me. And I have a choice between two methods, and one of them is pleasant, and one of them is unpleasant. I usually choose the pleasant one. It's very rare that I say, I know, I'll do it the most horrible way possible. So what gives you the idea that you can only do things in this horrible way? Do you think that that may be the answer? Do you think this is the only way you can get things done? Why, if I were in a good mood, I couldn't do this. If I were happy, I couldn't do this. If I were aware and in a really neat place, I couldn't do this, so I've got to be in this terrible place just to get it done. All right. It sounds weird, but maybe that's what you think. Do you think that that is that what you think is going on in you? This is the only way I can get this done.
Maybe when you're comfortable, it's easy just to go to sleep and be comfortable.
I was never comfortable when I was guilt-ridden. That don't hold water to me. You just got through telling me that when you're asleep, your motivation is to deal with this horrible guilt and punish yourself. And now you're telling me that's comfortable?
Maybe it's easier than...
Oh, I see. We're going to change the thesis now. From comfort to easy. I think that means you don't know what the hell you're talking about. That's my suspicion. Okay. was personally never comfortable with being guilt-ridden. I went to a lot of trouble to get rid of guilt. Because somebody told me how. And I used that method. There's nothing I wanted to get rid of, I think, faster than guilt. I was one of the first on the list to go. I don't like feeling guilty, do you?
How do you do that?
Oh, it's very simple. You just do whatever you feel guilty about until you don't feel guilty anymore. Just keep doing it until you don't feel it anymore. So if you have this bad habit of kicking old ladies' feet from out from under them when they cross the street, go do it to a bunch of old ladies until you think it's fun and don't care about it anymore, and then you'll never feel guilty about it again. You can kick old ladies' feet out from under them without any guilt whatsoever. But the interesting thing is that when the guilt is gone, you can also not do it. And I've noticed when people feel guilty about things, they can't stop doing it. Have you noticed that? Otherwise, why would they still feel guilty about it? They keep doing it over and over and over again. And it's a weird thing, but once you take the guilt out of it, then you look at it and say, why am I knocking this poor old lady's feet out from under her? I don't want to do this, and you stop. When you feel guilty about it, you just can't seem to stop. You keep doing it anyway. Isn't that about right? It's weird, but it's true. So it's worth, since you're doing it anyway, do it until you don't have to. And you don't feel guilty about it one bit. It's really worth doing. When I can think clearly about a thing, I can decide whether I want to or not. When I'm busy feeling guilty, I'm in such a terrible state that I end up doing it anyway. That's been my experience. So, I'm going to leave you at this. We'll take a short break to kind of consider this for a second. Right? More off the top of the head questions that you change whenever anybody asks you what it means. That's ridiculous, okay? See if you can come up with an answer. Even if it's, I don't know. How come I know about this and I insist on staying in this other place that I claim I don't like? It doesn't make any sense, does it? What's going on? See if you can come up with some answers. I know I sort of sprung the question on you. That's not fair. So I'll give you a little time to consider it, okay? And then we'll come back. Subject. What's going on with this funny thing that you do? If you do have ideas, let's pull it out and look at it, okay? Don't keep it private.
It's because I'm not paying attention to even notice them in a way that's less effective.
Okay, I apologize, but I didn't hear all of what you said.
I'm not even paying enough attention to notice that what I'm doing is not good. I'm just doing the thing that I've always done out of habit, and not paying attention to whether or not it's pleasant or unpleasant or working or not working. It's just what I've done, and so I continue to do it.
Yeah, and we call that being asleep. And that's exactly what this question was about. Why would I know that I could be awake? Now, maybe you don't know that yet, okay? You haven't been around as long as something, but I'm kind of directing the question at people who've been here for a while. Why would you know that you could do things differently and yet continue to do it without awareness in your sleep, not even asking yourself whether it's pleasant or unpleasant or whatever? What's going on here? That is the question. I totally understand that that is what's going on, yeah. When you're asleep, questions like this don't arise, do they? You just do it by habit. You do it unquestioningly. That is what we're trying to look at. So if I know about an alternative, what keeps me doing it this really dumb way, this really unpleasant way? Somebody during the break said, so are you saying that we could just turn off all that machinery and that clutter and that yap, 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 and do things without it? Like, I just said, you're just now hearing that? What else have I been talking about for the last Lord knows how many years? So that gives us an interesting little clue, doesn't it? It's unthinkable to me that I could actually live that way. How come? Why can't I even conceive of that? So I hear about it, and then 2 years later or 3 years later, I ask somebody, are you actually saying I can do that? Well, no, actually, I don't think I'm just saying it. I do believe I'm selling it at the best of my ability. I'm advocating it. Isn't that about right? Anybody not get that impression? I'm not just saying that, am I? I'm doing my best to sell you on it, huh? Now, I'm apparently not the salesman I thought I was, but I did learn that a long time ago. I can sell ice to Eskimos. Okay? I'm a very good salesman. But there's one product I have never been able to sell. You know what that is? A good mood. Nobody wants it. I can sell you something you don't need. Okay? Hell, I could sell you air. But I can't seem to sell you on a good mood. You won't buy it. You act like you do, but then you go off and get back into that weird, miserable place again. Interesting, isn't it? You'd think everybody'd want that. So I'm not just saying you could. I'm doing my best to sell it to you. Boy, have you got sales resistance to this one. How come? That's the question. So when you say you just do it by habit and yada, 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 what you said, I'm not making light of it, I just don't feel like repeating the whole thing, okay? Is it actually what you'd want to do? I mean, if you sit and think, consider it now, is that what you want?
No.
Well, that's what interests me. If you don't want it, and you have seen that there is another possibility, even if only briefly. Now, I know that's why the person asked me the question. You understand? All that means is that just recently, they started to experience the machinery going off and being in a different place, and so now they're starting to get, oh, that's what he's trying to get me to see. Before then, they couldn't even consider it because they'd never experienced it, so they didn't even know what the hell I was talking about. So it just went in one ear and right out the other, which in their case, by the way, is pretty common. But suddenly, they're starting to get some experience that says, wow, this is possible sometimes under some conditions for a short period of time, and are you saying this would be neat to do all the time? Uh-huh. Couldn't even hear it before. It didn't make sense. I can accept that. It makes sense to me. But that's what I'm asking. If you have experience in this, though, how come you don't seem to want it? What's going on? And so far, the only real answer I have received from anyone is, because I've always done it this way. That's really what all these answers come down to, right? Mm-hmm. Is guilt answer. Because I'm punishing myself. That's the same answer in a way, isn't it? Because I've always done it that way. Don't you want to learn anything else? Yeah.
I noticed that when I'm in conflict and living in the slums, it's all about vanity. Violently trying to be the picture of self, and I think I don't. It's not pleasant. I know it's not pleasant, it's not preferable to when I'm not doing that briefly, but I want to be somebody, and those
that's only half the truth. Okay.
Okay.
If we're gonna say it's about vanity. If the picture that I have is also the way it is, would you be doing that? So you're only telling half the truth, aren't you? You're leaving out one part of it, which is, I want to be here instead of here. Somewhere else, obviously,
yeah.
Or you wouldn't be
very
doing, you wouldn't be struggling so hard to be something else. So you're leaving that part out. It's implied, but you're not actually saying it. But that's part of it. Without that, none of it would be there. I gotta begin with that, isn't that right? I realize that I'm here, and I don't like it here. And so I do all this weird stuff to get somewhere else. Mm-hmm. Well, now the interesting thing is that is the answer. If you look at that part of it and don't leave that out anymore, the answer is obvious. Apparently only to me. Now we know how come people do it. You don't get it, huh?
We believe it's real.
Huh?
Because we believe that it's real.
I think you've got to go to sleep to believe that a lie is real, don't you?
Well, it provides a context for us to see that.
Provides what?
Like, for example, if you're living in a world where everyone is 6 foot tall, you wouldn't know that you're tall unless you have a person that's 5 foot tall. So in order to experience something else, you need to experience all the misery or the
everyday. That's bullshit. That's just bullshit. I have an imagination. I could conceive of a place where people were only 3 feet tall. Don't you ever read fiction? Haven't you ever heard of dwarves? I mean, people imagine things all the time. You could imagine it. You might not understand what you're saying. You might not know you're tall, whatever that means, but you're not. You're 6 feet. That's not tall. Maybe there are 12 feet people around. And you're actually a dwarf. I can imagine that. So what you just said actually is meaningless. It's only meaningful if there are no five feet people around, and I say, then you're not tall. 6 feet is only tall for humans, isn't it? I don't know if it's tall for everything that exists in the entire universe. There may be some beings out there that average 12 feet, and they think we were little midgets. How the hell do I know? And I can conceive of that. I'm not quite sure what you're saying, if you're using that as the answer, because I can't be bothered to sit down and use the imagination and even conceive there might be a better way. Well, then I think we're just right back where we started from. I'd call that a sleep. That's what sleeping people do. They're pretty much convinced that what they're doing is the one and only way to do anything. It's kind of what you said, isn't it? But I'm asking, how come? I'm questioning whether it has to be that way or not. What do you mean you can't conceive of anything else? And why are you here? If you can't conceive that there might be another way to do things, what the hell are you doing here? It seems to me that people who can't even conceive of anything else don't show up here. I notice the whole population of Houston is not in this room. Most people couldn't be any less interested, could they? They just seem to think that the way it is the way it is, and there's nothing you can do about it. And I know about that theory. But I'm asking you. You must have a different theory, or else you're just here because you like her. That's possible too, I think. I'm not actually interested, just don't want my girlfriend to think I'm not interested in her, so I come to this stupid meeting. I don't know. As good a reason as any, I guess. It sounds to me like people are saying, I don't really know. So I'm using an excuse. And the excuse appears to me to be because I have no choice. Am I wrong about that? I don't have a choice. Well, do you want a choice? And I thought that was the whole setup. I'm repeating self. I don't think you're hearing what I'm saying. You do have a choice, because you have experienced something else. Now, if you're sitting here and you're saying, I don't know this other thing you're talking about, then I accept that answer. I have no choice. That makes sense. But I'm talking to mostly, not everyone, but mostly a bunch of people who've been around for years, and they have experienced something else. Maybe only briefly, maybe only glimpses of it, but they have. And what I'm getting back is, I don't have a choice. That doesn't make sense, does it? So I don't think we're anywhere near an answer to this question at this point. You sure know you have a choice, don't you? From personal experience, isn't that right? It was in what you said. I do that other thing some of the time. This is my understanding of why I don't, because I think I'm a terrible person somehow. I don't like me very much. And when that happens, I struggle really hard. This is my hypothesis that I'd like you to consider. You have no choice but to sleep, because it's the only way you can lie. You can't lie when you're awake, can you? And you want to lie. Very simple. And there's only one place to lie, isn't there? In your sleep. So since there are a zillion things that you simply do not want to be aware of, you have no choice but to choose sleep. And you're making up all these excuses about why you don't have the choice. But the fact is, you did make a choice. You chose sleep rather than know something. What you think of them apples? You made a choice. You want to sit here and pretend that it was forced on you. Because apparently that's another comforting lie. I don't believe it's true. I think you chose to go to sleep rather than know something. It was the only way you could not know.
What
None that I can see. Not a single benefit that I can see in that. So I think you're going to have to answer the question, not me. What is the benefit? I have a suspicion that that we went just a little bit too fast, okay? So I'll come back to his question in a moment. Do you get that? Does that ring true at all? You could wake up. But you do know that if you wake up, you are going to become aware of a lot of things that you would prefer not to know. Isn't that about right? They're very unpleasant to you, very painful, very disturbing. Isn't that about right? Like, I'm not the person that I think I am in your particular case. That's kind of, I think just about everybody is doing that for the same reason. Her case just made it a bit obvious, didn't it? So in that case, it's, I don't want to know what I'm really doing because I don't like what I'm doing. So I will go to sleep to keep from knowing. I suspect what it is a person is trying not to know is not as simple to categorize, although I am going to make an effort even to do that. I love making categories of things. It's fun. And I'm sure I'll miss some things, but I think that's the essence of it. I must go to sleep to keep lying. I don't know how to lie when I'm awake. It's very hard, because I'm aware of the fact that I'm lying. What do you think? This puts a whole different spin on things, because I want to play the game that I'm a victim. You notice how often I've gotten that one. I've had to repeat this over and over and over again. It'd be interesting for people who watch the tape to see just how many times it was said over again, because somebody kept coming back and saying, but I'm a victim. I have to. And I'm suggesting, no, you're not a victim. You did it. It was your choice. You wanted to. You wanted to go to sleep. You understand? You did it on purpose. What do you think? Does that fit what you see? Because I don't want to know a bunch of stuff. To answer your question, as far as I can tell, the benefit is that I escape pain, or so I believe. And since I go to sleep, I don't even pay attention to the fact that actually I don't. That's the belief. If I don't know this, it won't hurt, because it hurts. And then you go to sleep and it hurts anyway, and you don't even notice because now you're not paying attention. In fact, it probably hurts worse. What do you think, Maite? You think all that struggle is less painful than just sitting there and saying, God, I'm a shit?
More.
Huh?
It hurts more.
And a lot longer, doesn't it? God, I'm a shit. It only takes a couple seconds. It's over with. But you don't realize that. Because now you're asleep, struggling to change it, to get away from this very unpleasant fact. I think that's what's going on. What do you think? You come here, you say you want to learn about a different kind of existence. You appear to be very interested, and then you don't do it. And the theory that I'm presenting is because when you tried it, you started to become aware of a lot of things you didn't want to know, so you chose to go back to sleep, to forget, to escape knowing. That's the theory. It's the only hypothesis I can come up with for this very peculiar behavior. Why would people know about a better way of life and refuse to live it? They don't do that with money. I don't know too many people who look at money and say, gee, money makes life much easier. I think I'll be poor. You know many people who do that? They don't do it with sex. They don't look at sex and say, gee, I really like that. I think I'll stop. So it really doesn't make any sense, does it, for somebody to see that this is preferable to me. I really prefer, if I have a choice between being asleep and being awake, I'd really prefer to be awake. It's a lot nicer place. I'm going to have to deal with the same stuff, whether I'm awake or asleep, but it's a lot more enjoyable. It's easier. All these nice things. And then they choose to go to sleep. That's very hard to believe, isn't it? I think they go to sleep to escape. I don't want to know. It's the only thing I can see. And I do see that. This is not a theory in the sense of I figured it out. I've been watching. And I've noticed that when people do go to sleep, it's almost always to avoid a very unpleasant fact. And the interesting thing is that most of the time they don't even know what they're avoiding. Mm-hmm. So it's pretty damn effective, isn't it? You can see why people do it, huh? They don't even know what they don't want to know. So I'd say it has a good benefit, if that's your aim, to not know. You pay one hell of a price for it. But apparently not knowing, not that thing, is so important to you, so valuable, that you're willing to pay the price. I did notice back in the days of what often as I like to call it, take a weekend trip to hell. And every now and again, I've been working really hard and being aware. And said, gee, you know, I'd really like to indulge self in a nice, good bout of self-pity about now. And that sounds like a really fun thing to do. And I've been working really hard. I can do it for a few hours, and I'll be okay. I call those a weekend trip to hell, right? You read a little brochure, and you see something that catches your eye, and you say, yeah, I think I'll vacation in hell. That sounds like a nice spa they got there in the burning lake, you know? So you go there. And you forget this one little rule of hell, that before you can get in, there's an entrance fee, and you have to drink the water of forgetfulness. Okay? They make you do that just as you're going in. That's the price of admission. That and the coin for Charon, you know. I don't know if you're aware of that, but in the old Greek mythology, there were two things you had to do to get into hell. One was pay off Charon. I think that was his name, is that right? And the other one was to drink from the river of Lent, which is a Greek word for forgetfulness. Somewhere along the line, I caught on to what you forget is that there's anything but hell. You forget there is any other place. And so your weekend trip becomes months. Until suddenly, the water of the River of Lent begins to wear off, and you say, gee, I haven't always been in hell. So after a while, it kind of occurred to me I couldn't afford even a few moments, because my little few moments ended up being days or weeks. And that's when I started saying, yeah, that's a weekend trip to hell, okay? But some of the time, that's what it was. There was some pleasure that I wanted to get. And I would, for some reason, believe that the only way I could get that pleasure was to be asleep. And so I would often do it for some reason other than to avoid being aware of something. Sometimes it was to get a pleasure, and I didn't think I could do it any other way. And that was the favorite one for Phil, self-pity. Okay. Apparently the only way I could get anybody to love me was to feel sorry for myself. And I could only do that in the sleep. What a pitiful state of affairs that is, huh? You see, at that time, Phil was in a pretty bad place that he believed that. But I did notice that one every now and again. I would want to indulge self in some little pleasure. And I believe the only way to do that was to go to hell and forget and go to sleep. So I'd happily do it until I caught on that that wasn't such a great idea. Once I started noticing that my little hour or two that I thought I could afford became weeks, and I started reconsidering that indulgence. Maybe that pleasure isn't worth the price I'm paying for it. I'm going to stop doing it. But I did notice that as well. I suspect if you look, there are instances of that, aren't there? Where you go to sleep in order to get some little pleasure that you think you can only get that way. And I will give you that. The only way I know how to feel sorry for self is to be asleep. So I decided I didn't like that pleasure anymore. Wasn't worth it. Price was too high. It's the only thing I know of for continuing to sleep when you know of something else. Most people, they sleep because they think that's the only thing there is. And if somebody talks about something else, they think they're being goofy. It's understandable, isn't it? So I would expect them to sleep. That's the only option they have. That's normal. But it doesn't make sense for people who know something different, does it? You know it's not your only option. As far as I can tell, those are the only two reasons to choose sleep. Now, when I started doing that little thing of taking weekend trips to hell, which I remember very clearly, I knew I was doing it. I didn't kid myself. I knew what I was doing. I want to indulge myself in this. That's what I was thinking. I really want to do this. And I consider a little bit and decide whether I thought I could afford it. And what I discovered is I can't. Because I always go bankrupt every time I do it. Doesn't matter how much money I got in the bank. It always costs me more than I have. I didn't know that until I did it a few times, and then I started. But I didn't kid myself about it, okay? I want to indulge myself in this stupid feeling. But this one I know we pretty much kid ourselves about, don't we? I don't want to be aware of something. And I don't even want to know that I don't want to be aware of it. So I don't even want to realize that I decided to go to sleep. I don't even want to be that aware to know what I'm doing. I decided to sleep rather than face this. I'm not what I thought I was. It's a simple thing. It really is. It's a simple thing. Whenever I talk about vanity and pride, I almost always tell that story. That was the experience I had too when I decided to make an inventory of vanity. I made this nice list of things and said, okay, this is the false picture of self. This is what I believe about self. And I made a nice list, okay? And I looked at most of those things and said, they're all lies. The entire list is a lie. But most of them, I really would like to be that. It's true. I do want to have that particular attribute. It's true. I find that very, very neat. And I would like to have that as an attribute of me, except I don't. So I said to self, wouldn't it make more sense to work at getting it than to lie and then be upset every time I find out I don't have it? And that's what I started doing. I actually took that list as the things that I wanted to develop. And I worked at them. Because I wanted them. So acknowledging that it wasn't true became a great asset. And now some of those have become so much attributes of Phil that people can't even tell they weren't ever there before it started on that. There are some of them that I never even talk about, but everybody knows. You want to know what one of them is? This is a big thing to Phil. I wanted to be generous. That was something I wanted very, very much. I looked at self, and that was on the list of vanity, that I was generous. And I looked at behavior, and I said, you are the biggest miser I've ever seen in my entire life. That's the fact. And so you have to do this weird game to remember only those few times when you've ever given anyone anything at all and use that as an example of your great generousness and ignore the fact that you're so stingy you squeak when you walk. Okay? And I did not like seeing that. Generosity was one of the attributes that I really wanted to say I've made real. So I went to work on it. And every single time that little miserly urge came up that said, oh, I can't give that away because it's my last one, and then what will I do? And I'll never get another one. And besides, I don't even like them. I threw it away. Because I thought it was scary to do it. And what I wanted to be was generous. I didn't want to be stingy. So many times even with money, I'd give somebody the last money I had. If they wanted $100 and that's all I had was $100, I'd give them that $100 and wonder where the hell I was going to get dinner tonight. I never talk about self as generous, ever, do I? And yet I know very few people who don't see Phil as a generous person, do you? So now, what makes more sense? What you describe? Or saying, yeah, it's true. There's not a generous bone in this body. I think I'll go get some generous bones. Because I want to be generous. Or whatever it is, you understand? Generosity is a thing that I rarely ever speak of. Or if I do, it's always, you know, just as an abstract thing you might consider. But it's something I wanted very much. And I don't think there's any doubt that I developed that, do you? I never have to call attention to it. I never have to do a thing. I just do what I do. And sometimes these days, I am still stingy on occasion. I don't care. So I didn't say I was consistently generous. It's one of the neat things about doing a thing consciously. You can also choose not to. You're not compelled to do it. And that's what made sense to Phil to do with the list of vanity once it was made. Number one, I'm going to stop defending self. I'm going to stop lying. and see the truth. And some of the things that were on the list, I didn't even care about myself. It's like, I don't know who put that on the list. I don't even personally give a damn about it. So the fact that I'm not that is fine with me. I'm willing to just forget about it entirely, okay? I tell people all the time, good was on that list. I was sort of forced to put it on there. A lot of pressure was put on me to put good on the list, okay, when I was a little kid. And I did finally cave and succumb and put it on there. And then 20 years later, when I looked at the list, I said, well, who put that there and scratched it off? I don't want to be good. I don't care about being good. I'm not even sure anymore what good is. You guys be good if you want to. I don't know anything about the subject. Don't ever ask me about it. I know nothing about it. I threw away the idea a long time ago. I don't like it. That's all I learned about being good, is I don't like it. But anything beyond that, I don't know. And then I found out that everybody actually knows that. They even made a saying about it. It's such common knowledge, okay? Everything fun in life is either illegal, immoral, or fattening. You ever heard that one? So everybody knows that being good sucks. I decided I wanted to have fun. And that often required that I do things that were, that saying is true, either illegal or immoral or fattening. And I went in and did them all. Okay? So to me, it makes sense. So to go ahead and take the pain and be aware of that thing. And see if there's something I can do. And it may be very hard. I may have to deal with it for years. It may not be simple and obvious. But I'd really prefer that than having to live in hell. Because I don't even want to know about it. That's this one's choice. And I have this weird suspicion that anybody who actually wants to be a conscious, aware, living, created being, I'm going to probably make the same choice. I can't afford to live in ignorance anymore. Years and years and years ago, someone asked a question of Phil. They said, is ignorance really bliss? And the only thing I could say is, not for me. I lived in ignorance for years. There was nothing blissful about it at all. It was hell. I don't know, it won't work. It won't hurt, I'm sorry. That's one of our operating principles, isn't it? It's one of the things that got us into sleep in the first place, and it's what keeps us there today. If I don't know, it won't hurt. So we take pain pills constantly, don't we? If I don't know, it won't hurt. So sometimes that pain that you're masking with the aspirin day in and day out is going to kill you eventually, huh? It's true, isn't it? I know a lot of people who take aspirin every single day of their life because they have some ache or pain. And one of these days, that ache or pain that they're denying even exists is going to kill them. So maybe it's true. If I don't know, it won't hurt. Do I still escape the consequences? Wouldn't it make more sense to not have the consequences of that thing, to know it and maybe do something about it, than to just be blissfully ignorant and then get the consequences anyway? That makes sense to this one. What do you think? So, it's about time for lunch. Since we always take a long lunch anyway, because, you know, I discovered on the plane that the reason why everyone can't concentrate is because they don't get enough sleep. That was an article I read on the way here. I actually always thought it was the other way around. I thought the reason they couldn't concentrate was because they were asleep all the time. But I was informed in this article that inability to concentrate is from lack of sleep, not too much. So I've been wrong all these years. Scientific evidence has proved me wrong, okay? But I suspect that while your body is digesting food, you don't have enough energy to concentrate, so it'll take some extra time, okay? It takes a lot of energy to digest food. Consider this, all right? I'd like to go on from here. But there's not much point in going on from here if you don't see for yourself this may at least be part of it. You can hedge your bet if you want and say, oh, I'm sure there's more. But let's see if we can see that this really is part of it, isn't it? I choose sleep. It is not something that happens to me, except sometimes. Nothing's 100%, okay? But most of the time, I choose to go to sleep. It did not just happen to me. I did it so I could escape knowing something, being aware of something. And the only way to do that is to lower the awareness into some crippled state called sleep. Isn't that about right? If I leave it functioning well, how am I going to ignore that thing? Unless, of course, I can just put no value on it. That is another method, and I am aware of that. I usually ignore music by just putting no value on it whatsoever, and I stop hearing it. I know it's still going on, but it just vanishes as far as I'm concerned, okay? That is another method of being unaware of something, you know. Put no value on it at all. But how many people can do that? If Muzak annoys you, you put a lot of value on it, don't you? And so you can't forget it's there, can you? Because you made it the first value that it stopped because you hate it. You see? Well, it annoys me too. So I put absolutely no value on it whatsoever because I know very well that one of the things that this body does is constantly filters out stimulus. That's what it does. I've known that since I was very young. I am overwhelmed by more information from the senses than I can ever possibly process. Unless I'm in some way out altered state, maybe, okay, that I don't normally live in. It's just too much. So the body filters it out. And I learned a long time ago what gives it the criterion for what to filter out. Whatever I don't care about at all, it just discards, and I don't even know what's happening. So it's really simple. If you don't like something that's going on, put no value on it. It'll vanish as far as you're concerned. It has to come up and hit you in the head for you to notice it. It has to bump into you, okay? Because that's the way our bodies work. They're constantly ignoring things. Any questions or comments before we take a break?
Can I ask you something?
Sure.
I remember several years ago you were talking about observing the not eyes, and if you did that, you would become aware of some other mode of consciousness. I remember that discussion several years back. Mm-hmm. And
actually, being aware of the not-eyes is another level of consciousness. That's the only reason why I can make that promise. It's a tricky promise. Because really, nobody can guarantee you anything, okay? But that is another level of consciousness.
And are you going to talk about how to wake up?
practice. I usually do at one point or another. It's kind of an obsession of mine. I'll try and do it this weekend. Any other questions or comments? Okay. Consider that, please, okay? Let's see if we can at least accept that as looking that it has an element of truth in it, okay? And then we'll see where we can go with that. But if you're going to reject it because you don't like it, understand? That's what I just said. Something is unpleasant to you, you don't like it, so you simply reject it. It happens all the time. And if that's going to happen, you know, all the rest of the stuff we talk about will go in one ear and out the other. For you, anyway. I'll do it anyway for the people who will listen. If you want to make some value out of it, I think you've got to at least see for yourself that there's some truth in it, and it would be worth looking into. Okay. Shall we? Activity. It's just expending energy for no apparent reason. And the second one comes from an understanding. And somebody told me a story recently. They asked me if it was anything like true. I don't quite know why they asked me that, because I sort of talk about it all the time. But they said that they read a story about some great Sufi master who was approached by a student who wanted to know God. And the Sufi master said, well, I can't do anything to show you what's necessary right now. The conditions aren't here, but in a little while I'll come and get you and I'll show you what needs to be done. And the student agreed to that. A little while later, the great Sufi master came and knocked on the student's door and took them down to the beach. And they asked them to come out in the water with them. And then they tripped them and held them underwater for several minutes. When they finally let go of them, of course, the student, who dearly loved the great Sufi master, came up pissed as hell, screaming and yelling, saying, "What are you doing? Trying to kill me?" And the Sufi said, "When you want to know God as much as you wanted that breath of air, come back and talk to me. Because that's what it takes. It's a fact. It's been known for a very long time. And I doubt if there's very many things that you actually want that much. Huh? That you see it as a matter of life or death. That's why we call it increasing necessity. The word necessity means I will die without this. Do you understand? Doesn't mean I just wish or want it. It means I need it. I will die without it. That's how much desire it takes to do the work. All right? I've got to be convinced that this incredible effort is necessary to my life to bother doing it. Otherwise, I would simply prefer to continue hiding from all these unpleasant things in sleep. Because I don't see that I'm really going to have to pay that big a price for that decision. I sure don't see that that's going to kill me. But it will. You understand? I'm willing to take a look at this and stop hiding, because a lot of the things that I see I find very painful to deal with. I don't want to. I might discover the necessity to do it. I don't know how I'm going to gain that kind of necessity, where it's going to come from, when I keep hiding from the thing that would give it to me. This is unpleasant. You understand that about the worthless thing? Where are you going to get the necessity to be a conscious being when you're hiding from what would give it to you? You don't think that if you faced that horrible feeling that you'd have a hell of a good reason to do the work and discover for yourself that it's all an illusion? There's no such thing as those standards and ideals. You don't think that would give you a lot of necessity if you sat in that pain?
Probably would.
I suspect it would too. So I'm busy getting rid of what I need to do the work. And my method is to go to sleep and make some effort to be comfortable with the fact that I am dying. That these ideals that I live by are interfering with peace of mind enough that it is going to kill me. And I know in this day and age, that's totally unbelievable. Because we all know that what destroys me is little bitty bacteria and viruses and accidents, huh? It's not the fact that I'm disturbed all the time. We have a perfectly good explanation for what destroys me. Thanks to modern science, it's little and bitty invisible things. It's not the fact that I'm always upset. So we don't see that relationship. This is killing me. But you might see that it's making your life a living hell. Maybe that'd be good enough. Any questions or comments about that? If you really want to do this, you need to do the second part of the work, increasing necessity, okay? I don't think you can do it without it. I may be wrong. I don't know everything, but I think this is a necessary part of becoming conscious. You've got to not just want it, but need it. It's got to be that strong a desire. I don't think you'll go through the part of the journey that is unpleasant. You understand? The whole journey is not pleasant. There are parts of it that are horrible. And being honest with self is one of the parts that really is very unpleasant. And I don't want to do it. I don't want to go through that. I think you've kind of demonstrated over the last several years that this is not just a story, huh? When it starts getting unpleasant, you have trouble getting the motivation to continue, huh? Because you neglected the part about seeing things honestly enough that you needed to do this. You still think that you can use methods that don't work, that I can just go to sleep and hide and pretend to be okay. You'd kind of think that after several years of watching this, that you'd catch on. I don't think this is going to end. I think it is a stupid method. I can sort of excuse it when people aren't even paying attention. They can make up a belief like that. Well, you know, someday it's going to work. Although I have had fun on occasion asking them if they ever met anybody it worked for. I've seen a lot of old people on their deathbed, and they didn't look like they were, like, really happy at the end. It looked like everybody else, most of them. There are always exceptions. Doesn't seem to work, does it? Any questions or comments? Folks are constantly asking, okay, I need the necessity. What do I do to get it? What do you do to increase necessity? Stop lying. That's all there is to it. If you were honest about your current state of existence, I think you would be burning to do the work. That's always the answer. People go away frustrated. What a stupid answer. But as far as I can tell, that's about the best one there is, okay? Just stop lying. I think if you are honest with self, you will have very good reasons to analyze ideals. You'll be quite disturbed. You'll want more than anything else to do the work. What you think? Give it a shot. If there's no questions or comments, I'll wrap this up. I have no clue if pointing this out is going to make any difference at all. I just don't know. It really is baffling. People can see an entirely different state of existence that is obviously preferable, and we'll just leave it at preferable, okay? And then go back to hell. Even if it's not a very uncomfortable hell, I am aware that most of you are not suffering that badly. More is to pity. It's not that bad a hell. But it's still strange. Why would anyone go back to hell at all, even if it's a fairly pleasant hell? It's still hell. It's still bondage. There is still suffering in it, isn't there? There's still misery. There's still struggle. And you catch a glimpse of another life. It's kind of mystifying why that isn't motivation enough. I want that. But it isn't, very clearly. We've had some dramatic demonstrations of that. But it's just not enough. I don't know if pointing this out is going to get folks to see. I really need to be honest enough to get some necessity here. I can't just go on pretending like I have enough, because I obviously don't. And stop the pretending, the excuses, and the blaming. I don't know. We'll see. It'll be interesting. We can always hope. It's free. Don't fill your belly. Any questions or comments?
Okay. Well, what do you do next? I mean, what's the next step?
It's what? To get where?
To do the work.
You don't think that would be a good place to start? I mean, have you finished that one that you're asking about the next one?
I have no idea.
Okay. I might consider finishing this one before. Mandated instructions for the next one. for my recommendation. Usually when you point out something for a person to do and they ask you what's next, 2 seconds later, it means they're not going to do it anymore. Probably I know this one's going to occupy them for several years. It might be a week. That is usually what it means, huh? What's next? Yeah, I got that. I understand. Usually it means they're not going to do it. That's been my experience. Why don't you see what happens with a bit of honesty. I've been recommending that for years now. Be honest with yourself. I think you'll get the necessity you need. It's easy to say, but telling a bunch of liars to be honest is sort of foolish. Sort of look at me and go, what's that? What's honesty? Okay. So, I think I just answered the question, okay? Honesty is admitting what you're trying to avoid when you go to sleep. And that's easy enough. When you notice that you've gone to sleep, when you're in some upsetting circumstance, look back and say, what was I trying to do? I chose to sleep. What was I trying to do with sleep? What was my aim in choosing sleep? Maybe you'll see it. Maybe you'll be honest. Instead of pretending like it just happened to you. Or the favorite one. I had a massive knot-eye attack. So. That kind of reminds me of, the ghosts were really noisy last night. Yeah, so what? They can't touch you. What's your problem? All they can do is scare you. If you look at them and say, you're not physical. What are they going to do? Hit you with their ectoplasm? Hey, that hurts. That's kind of what it reminds me of. You know, these things keep walking through me. What do you care? Well, I don't like it. That's exactly what it is with a massive knot-eye attack, okay? A bunch of illusions all have a fake illusory war in your head. So, it's just noisy. You seem to be good at sleeping through it, so what's the problem? That's all it is, it's just noise. It can't do nothing unless... And that's exactly that's why I used the example of ghosts, you understand. All right? They can't do anything without your agreement. They're utterly, completely powerless unless they can get you afraid of them and get you to agree that they can hurt you, and then they suddenly can do anything they want, and then it becomes quite interesting. But if you walk in and say, no, I'm not agreeing that you're scary. You're just some tattered-looking, half-invisible thing. Can't do a damn thing. You gotta go along with it. And that's just the way it is with the knot-eyes. So they're having a war in your head. I know, it's called Armageddon. Didn't you know that? Good and bad are fighting it out. Except the bad doesn't believe it's good. So it's good and good fighting it out. Called Armageddon. You're the battlefield. I know. But there are also invisible nothings. If you can put up with the noise, which is a bit difficult to do, there's nothing they can do if you just laugh. You understand? That's a weird excuse. Any questions or comments? All right. I'm going to end this one, like I say, and do something different tomorrow. Answer some of this fellow's questions about what I can do.
People like to try and eat at 6.
Thank you.
Yeah.
See if they're willing.
I suspect that
Philip, can we do 6:30?
Oh, that was open.
Can we do 6:30?
Wrong Philip.